You save us now. They realized that the law couldn't save them, that the blood of bulls and goats couldn't save them, that their conscience had never been cleared, and they were crying out to be saved. And thank God, there is no other name given among men whereby men shall be saved but the name of Jesus. And every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We can confess now, or we can confess before the throne when it's too late. It's better to bow the hearts now. Let's bow our heads and pray before we look into the message today. Father, thank you for your great love wherewith you have loved us. Greater love has no man than this, that a man should lay down his life for his friends. But God, you became a man. Man sinned, man had to die, but we didn't have a life to give. We had all died spiritually because we had all sinned. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. There's none that does right. There's none that seeks after God, no, not one. You were the only one that had a life to give. So you became a man. You took all the sins of the world upon you, God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, and you took them away. John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." If, when we were enemies, and we were all enemies in our minds by our wicked works. We didn't want you. We had our backs to you. And yet, while we were enemies, you commanded your love toward us. And that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet enemies, you died for us. And if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to you by the death of your Son, much more now that we are reconciled, we shall be saved by your life. The Apostle Paul said that the mystery of the gospel hid from the ages is Christ in you, your only hope of glory. Thank you for coming into our lives, for living in our hearts, for saving us eternally. Help us to always bask in your glory, to surrender to you, to obey you. Yes, obey, not to be saved, but because we're saved. We are bought with a price and we're not our own. Conform us to the image of your dear Son, Father, and glorify yourself in our spirits and bodies that are yours, for we are bought with a price and we are not our own. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Open up our hearts and minds as we look into your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to wait for the slideshow. So the thought of our message today is the Lamb of God. This is a special, special year to me. Does anybody know what today is called? I know you do, right? We call this Palm Sunday, right? The real Palm Sunday was Sunday, April 10th. Next week is not Easter. Easter is not a Christian holiday. Easter has nothing to do with Jesus. Easter is the name of the goddess of fertility, hence the bunnies and the eggs. You know, I went over this in chapel this week with the school. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were told to bow down to the golden statue, they wouldn't. And they could have said, "God knows my heart. He knows I'm not worshiping the golden statue. I'll just bow down like everybody else, but God knows I'm not worshiping another God." And then when it comes to things like Easter, Easter goes by the winter solstice, or the spring solstice. So sometimes it's in March, sometimes it's in April. It moves around. And the goddess of fertility, to honor her, we have bunnies and eggs. That's fertility. Rabbits produce a lot, eggs. So in that day, they would sacrifice children and take their blood and dye eggs. And that's where the egg dyeing came from, was they were dyed with the blood of babies. And so we have continued that tradition, and we say it's for the children. God knows our hearts. But I don't mean to get on a tangent. But next week is not Easter. The 17th of April, Jesus rose from the grave, and it's resurrection. That's why if you say Happy Easter to me, don't be surprised if I don't come back with Happy Easter to you. I'll come back with Happy Resurrection Day, because I don't do Easter. I don't even speak Easter, because that's the name of a goddess, and it's not anything to do with Jesus. It's another God. But that's a side point, kind of. But I think it's important that we as Christians are not taken up with the deceptions that take place, but we worship Jesus only. So today we're going to talk about the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God, does anybody know what April 10th is? April 10th is very significant in history. It started back in Egypt. A guess is it's when the Passover lamb was chosen. April 10th. April is the first month of the year. God said that April would, Nisan would be the new beginnings. It goes like March to April. So April is the first month of the year, and April 10th is when the Passover lamb is chosen. And it's held until the 14th, and for 4 days they examine it to make sure it's a perfect lamb without spot or blemish, worthy to be sacrificed to God for sins. Because on that night in Egypt, the blood was put on the doorpost and lentils, right? As Dr. McMurtry told us, after sunset, when it gets dark, the date changes to the next day. God said in Genesis, he never says morning to evening. When he created, he said, and the evening and the morning were the first day. God starts the new day right after sunset when it gets dark. When it gets dark, that starts the next day. So we have to see how that dating system works. But we're going to take a little walk today with Jesus. I didn't want to do the full thing. He's in Bethany where he's raised Lazarus from the dead. He's with his friends in Bethany. He goes to Bethphage, which is the house of unripe figs. Then he goes up to the Mount of Olives, and we're going to trace it on the map a few times, but I'm not going to do the whole week. It would take a long time to go through everything, all the parables he used and all the things that he did. I'm going to pick out some highlights and go over those together today. So let's change our slide, and I want to look at the Lamb of God. I want to start off with Hebrews 10, 1 through 4 to let you see. How many of you would like to, every time you sin, to offer a lamb or another animal for your sins, a blood sacrifice? You know what happens when you do that? You know what happens when you bring a lamb every year? You remember your sins and your conscience is never clear. You can never forget your sin because you're reminded constantly. There was so much sacrifice going on that a chair was a forbidden piece of furniture in the tabernacle and in the temple, because every priest stood daily offering the same sacrifices which could never take away sins. Now, when Jesus offers himself, as we're going to see next week, he sits down because it's over. It is finished. But I want to look at this today, Hebrews 10, 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come. Now, the law was never intended to be the real thing. It's not the real thing. It's a shadow. You know, right now, I can see my shadow on the floor. I would never be able to tell you who it is, only I know who it is because I'm standing here. But there's no eyes, there's no ears, there's no missing hair or hair. There's no shirt color, there's nothing. It's a shadow. We're all born with our backs to God, and all we see is a shadow. It's not the reality. But when the Lord speaks to us and we turn and face the Son, then we're face to face with Jesus. That's called repentance. Repentance is changing your mind 180 degrees. I had my back to Jesus. I didn't believe in him, and now I do. But let's get back to this. So the law was only a shadow. The law was never intended to bring salvation. Do you know that? Nobody is saved by obeying the Ten Commandments. And I'll tell you this, nobody ever has except Jesus obeyed the Ten Commandments. I ask people a lot. They'll say, oh, you have to obey the Ten Commandments. I say, do you? No. If you say yes, then right there you're a liar, so we know you're not, because the Bible clearly says that nobody can be saved by the law. So the law was only a shadow of the good things to come, which is Jesus, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offered year by year, every Passover, continually make the comers thereunto perfect. So here's what we say. I hear a lot of people say this. I do my best for the Lord. I know I'm not perfect, but I do my best. I'm sorry, that's not good enough. God does not accept that. God does not grade on the curve. He does not accept anything short of perfection. He only accepts perfection. So if you say, I'm not perfect, then no, you're not acceptable to God. God doesn't grade on the curve. I had a person stop by and say, you know, if I mess up, I try to be better the next day. I try to be a good person. I try to be better. God's not interested in your trying. He's not interested in your trying to be good or trying to be better. He accepts only perfection. He said, be ye perfect as I am perfect. Be ye holy even as your Father in heaven is holy. Holy means set apart for God. So if any part of your life is not set apart for God, it's not good enough. How many people feel like you're in trouble now? We're in trouble, right? If that's the case, if God demands perfection and holiness, then all my efforts are in vain, right? And this is what Paul is getting to. Some people think Paul did not write Hebrews. I think he did for a lot of reasons. But he says that those offers, all those sacrifices could never make the person perfect. Was that a problem? Obviously, or he wouldn't have said it. Let's go to verse 2 and see what he says. So now in verse 2, for then would they not have ceased to be offered? If it would make you perfect, wouldn't you stop offering? If you could bring the blood of a lamb and be perfect before God, then you wouldn't need to offer a lamb anymore because your sins would be gone if you're perfect, right? So if that happened, if they could make you perfect, wouldn't they have ceased to be offered? Because that the worshipers, once purged, would have no more conscience of sins. Your conscience wouldn't bother you anymore. You'd be purged. That animal would have made you perfect. But it didn't, did it? The blood of bulls and goats could only temporarily cover sins. They could never take them away. They could never make your conscience clear. And there was never a law that could bring life. The Apostle Paul said in Galatians, if there could have been a law given that would bring life, then righteousness would come by the law. But if righteousness is by the law, he says, then Christ died in vain. And when people say, I'm still doing the Ten Commandments, they are saying that Jesus died in vain. That's a serious thing, that you're going to do it, you're going to perfect it. It's all Jesus or it's not at all. Now let's go to verse 3. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. So you know you sinned in March, or you sinned in December, you sinned in January, and you're trying to forget it, and then you come to Passover, and you're offering your animal for all the sins, and you're thinking, you're rehearsing all your sins and feeling terribly guilty and shamed. So there's always this remembrance made of sins. Verse 4. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. So what were these sacrifices about? What were these rules about? They were a shadow, not the reality. What was coming is what we're going to see now. The answer always was Jesus Christ. When did Jesus die on the cross? Before the foundation of the world. I was looking at a little movie clip. I'd love to show it sometimes. We live in three dimensions, actually four: length, width, height, and time. Time is a physical property. Let's stick with three. Three dimensions. This screen has two dimensions. It has a width and a height. It does not have depth. So if you were a creature on a two-dimensional plane, suppose you're a dot, and God wants to reveal himself to you, and he puts his finger through that screen, you'll see a small dot, it'll get bigger, and when he pulls his finger back, it'll get smaller and disappear. But you will not comprehend him. The color, the lines in the skin, the marks, the shape. There's no shape when you live in two dimensions. If I'm looking like at this top of this podium, I see a length and a width, and there were little two-dimensional creatures on here, They see only a sequence, but from up here, I can see the whole thing. So I'm outside of their little universe. They live in a two-dimensional realm. I'm outside of their realm. And so what looks like a sequence of them, I see the end over here. He's traveling across, but I already know where he's going. I can see the end because I'm not there. God is outside of time, so he knows the end from the beginning. God is not under time. So in his eyes, Adam and Eve arrive in his presence the same time I do when I die. And you say, that doesn't make sense. He's not in time. The whole history of man is one big open platform to him. Christ died. He already knew man would sin. Christ already died before the foundation of the world. We live in a sequence. God's not in that sequence. God already knows what you're going to do, what you're going to say. He already knew your sins before you committed them, and he paid for them. If you receive him, he already paid for all of them. Well, I know he paid for my past sins. Well, what do you call them, past sins? What sins were past? When Jesus died on the cross, which sins of yours were past and which were future? Well, in our little universe, our being in time, all my sins were future when he died on the cross. But when I received him, he only paid for those back. Well, if he only paid for those back, then what are you going to do about the ones you commit now? Without shedding of blood, that's a present progressive verb. It is not without the shed blood of Jesus. It doesn't say that. It says without shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. So if there's more forgiveness to be exercised, there has to be shedding of blood. And Hebrews, if you read that, says, then must he often have suffered since the beginning of the world. That means every time you sin, Jesus has to die, rise again, die, rise again. If I have to be forgiven again, he has to die again. Hebrews makes that clear. If we have more forgiveness to be exercised, if by that one offering he didn't do it, then he has to die again, and he's not going to. This is the final lamb. At a point in history, God manifests him, but it was already done in his eyes before the foundation of the world. This is our Passover lamb. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins. Let's go to that. Let's go to our next slide. So let's look at the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. This is a presentation of the final Passover lamb, the Lamb of God. All the others were shadows of what was to come of Jesus Christ. John 1:29, John the Baptist, the next day John saw Jesus coming unto him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, what? Everybody read it with me. Which taketh away the sin of the world. Does what? Covers it? Atone means to cover. Jesus did not atone. The word atonement is not in the New Testament. It was translated that way because of constant theological usage, it became acceptable. But it's not acceptable. The blood of bulls and goats atoned. Jesus propitiated. Propitiate means to take away. He did not cover your sins. He took them away. As far as the east is from the west, the east is from the west. That's the west right there. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed your transgressions from you. Every priest stands daily offering the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. We just saw that, right? But this man, when he offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The right hand means the position of power. He's the only one on the throne. When we get there, you're not going to see Father on a throne, a little baby throne with Jesus on it, the Holy Spirit on the throne. God the Father is a spirit. He fills all of universe and beyond. The only bodily portion, we're told that all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in Jesus Christ. Jesus is going to be on the throne of the Lamb of God. That's who's going to be on the throne. You can't put God the Father on the throne. He is everywhere. Jesus also was everywhere and still is in spirit, but he gave up dimensions of his being forever. What he did on the cross, what we'll look at next week, is only a small part of what he did. He gave up dimensions of his being, and he is still every bit man and every bit God, and there's a man on the throne of God. He's God and he's man. What it cost him is unimaginable. When we're with him and see the price that he paid out of love for us, it is going to blow our minds, because it cost him everything. It cost us nothing. And that's the gift of grace. Praise God. So let's move on now to the next slide. Continuing. So back up one. Shabbat Haggadol. Shabbat Haggadol is a special Sabbath. A Shabbat is a Sabbath. The Sabbath is Saturday. Sunday is not the seventh day. It is not the Sabbath. People say, oh, you shouldn't do anything on Sunday. Well, I'm telling you, I work all day on Sunday. Because this is not the Sabbath. Yesterday was, for the Jews, it started Friday when it got dark. But, and the Sabbath day's journey, as we learned, is the only distance you could walk, which was like a quarter of a mile or a fifth of a mile. It was a distance that the priest walked behind the Ark of the Covenant. You're not allowed. You go up through the Vere Road and see the Jewish synagogues. Those people walk on Saturday or on Friday evening sometimes. They walk, and they're not allowed to drive. They're not allowed to go any farther than about a fourth or a fifth of a mile. That's the limit on the Sabbath. We don't worship on the Sabbath. We worship on the eighth day. The eighth day is a number of new beginnings. So when you start back last week and you go through this process, Jesus rose actually on the eighth day, which is a whole new beginning. He started this week on Palm Sunday, and you move forward, we're on the eighth day is the day that Christians worship, because we don't work and then rest. We rest and then work. We were given salvation. We enter that rest, and what we do is the work of Jesus through us. We're not earning anything. Before, you work to earn a rest. Now we rest, and then we work through the power of the Holy Spirit in us. So the Shabbat Haggadol is the Sabbath before Passover, which is today. Today, all the Jews, if you go to if you, well, it actually was yesterday. If you went yesterday, they would say, this is, out of all the Sabbaths, out of all the Shabbats, we have them all year long. Shabbat Haggadol is the most important Sabbath to a Jew. It is the high holy Sabbath before Passover. And so this all is important. Jesus is presenting himself. Now, he wouldn't have traveled in on the Sabbath, because the Jews would have had a problem right away. He's presenting himself on the 10th as the Passover lamb, and he's also traveling. So he's coming in on the day after Shabbat Haggadol, and he's coming in to present himself in Jerusalem. He's going to go into the temple as the perfect Lamb of God. Now let's move down a little farther here. That's Sunday, April 10th, which is today. So Jesus, you can see the little red line. If you click on it, he's going to come up from Bethany and travel to the Mount of Olives. And then, because remember we said he was at Bethany, he waited there, he sent his disciples to find a donkey or an ass. And it's not bad to say ass. I deal with my farm kids all the time. I said, it's not a donkey, it's an ass. So we learn in our farm class, we learn equine is horses, bovine is cows, ovine is sheep, caprine is goats, asinine is donkeys, antonine is ducks, anserine is geese, canine is dogs, feline is cats, porcine is pigs. So they have to learn all that. So asinine, it's an ass. That's what the Bible calls it. It only became bad because people call somebody else a pig or an ass or something. It's not a bad word, and it's not a part of your body either, by the way. It is an animal. So Jesus tells them to find an ass and a colt, the foal of an ass. Now, a foal is in its first year. So once, like our donkey, once he passed a year, last August 21st, he became a yearling. So now he's considered a different name. The foal is under a year old. So he said, go find this ass and find this foal. And now Jesus is going to go up to Jerusalem, Because a donkey is the way a king travels. Kings do not ride horses, not in those days. Soldiers ride horses. Royalty always rides a donkey. So their king is coming. He does not come on a big white horse. He comes on a donkey as a king should. And let's see this. So now, let's go to the next slide. So now he's coming into Jerusalem with all the people. Hosanna, Hosanna. You save us now. We are lost. But you just are getting ready for Passover. We've been doing Passover every year. You know, Passover started in Egypt. It happened again. The second time it happened on Mount Sinai. The third time it happened at Jericho when they were going into the promised land. And it's been off and on. It's still celebrated. We've been doing Passover, and we're still not saved. So you, Messiah, you save us now. You, Lamb of God, save us now. There are thousands and tens of thousands of people coming from all over the world at this time to Jerusalem with lambs. But our eyes are on the Lamb of God, and that's what they're shouting. Okay, let's move to the next slide. The triumphal entry is fulfills the ancient prophecy, Zechariah 9:9. So see, this is way ahead of time. People who read the scriptures are watching. All right, we already know that it's this year, from the going forth of the proclamation to rebuild Jerusalem under the coming of the Yeshua HaMashiach shall be 483 years. Yeshua HaMashiach is the Messiah, okay? So Zechariah 9:9 says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, shout, daughter of Jerusalem, see your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So we're told how he's coming. We're told the year he's coming. We know he's coming at Passover to be the Passover lamb. How did you miss it? How did you miss it? The same way we miss it now. The coming of the Lord is so soon, and there's a lot of people missing it. There's still scoffers who say, all things continue as they were since our fathers fell asleep. So they eat, they drink, they're married and given in marriage even until the day that Noah entered the ark, and now there's everybody's just, it's business as usual, and don't realize Jesus is about to return. If you have not received him as Lord and Savior, now's a real good time to do it, because if you wait one day too long, there is no salvation after you leave here. When you die, you don't get to be there at the throne and say, oh, you know, by the way, I was really thinking about this, and I'm ready to do it now. Too late. It's too late. Receive him as Lord and Savior. And now when you do, the book of Hebrews says, by one offering, he has perfected forever those that are sanctified. Sanctified means set apart for God. When you receive Jesus, you're set apart for God, and he has perfected you forever. It's not your perfection. It's the perfection of Jesus. It's the holiness of Jesus. We are clothed in his righteousness. Are you as righteous as Billy Graham? Yeah. Are you as righteous as the Apostle Paul? Yes. Are you as righteous as Jesus Christ? Yes, that's not blasphemy, because his righteousness is my righteousness. He clothed me in his righteousness. Otherwise, I would never be accepted before the throne of the Father. I go in boldly. He says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest, not the holy of holies on earth, which was a shadow, but into heaven itself, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, not the old way. The law is the old dead way. It's the dead letter of the law, a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the flesh, through the veil, that is his flesh. His flesh was torn, the veil of the temple was rent, and having a high priest over the house of God, a real high priest, the final high priest, and when there is a change of the priesthood, there is of necessity a change of the law. The book of Hebrews says that. That's not me. When you change the priest, because Jesus is from the tribe of Judah, of which no mention was made at the altar, he's not of the Levitical priesthood. He's a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, without father, without mother, having neither beginning of days nor end of life. He is a priest forever, and God says in Hebrews, when you change the priest, you have to change the law. It's a necessity. If there's a new priest, you must have a change in the law. And Jesus changed it. Receive his righteousness, love God, love your neighbor. He says all the law and all the prophets, law, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the Tanakh, and all the prophets, everything else, is all comprehended, all fulfilled in this. Love God, and you can't do that without Jesus in you because he is love, and love your neighbors yourself. That takes care of everything. That takes care of everything. Jesus in you. Praise God. So here he comes riding on the donkey. Let's move to the next slide. Jesus comes up to Jerusalem, and this is what happens. And when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it. Why? Saying, if you had known, even you, at least in this day, when I came on a donkey, when I came at the right year, when everything that was prophesied is coming down, how many prophecies were fulfilled just at this time of Jesus? 300 and something. I had some of them listed, but it was too much to go over in this period. If you had known, even in this day, of you, at least in this day, the things that belong to your peace, but now they are hid from your eyes, for the days shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee round and keep thee in on every side and shall lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. God has come and you missed it. And we'll see next week in 70 AD on April 14th, Passover, when visitors from all over the world were there, the Romans besieged Jerusalem and 1.1 million non-combatant, not soldiers, 1.1 million citizens died. And not one stone was left. They burned the temple, the gold melted, and Roman soldiers pried every stone apart with their spears to get the gold, and not one stone was left upon another because they rejected God, their Messiah. But they're worshiping him. They're doing the law, and Christians do that now, but I'm fulfilling the law. It's not just Jesus. I have to finish it. I have to do my part. It's me plus Jesus. Why did God put Abraham into a deep sleep and walk alone through the sacrifice? You're supposed to have a bilateral covenant. No, it was unilateral. God said, it's a covenant. It's one-sided. I'm making it. And no matter what happens, I'm fulfilling the covenant. And with all the mistakes and all the sins of Jacob and his sons, the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. That means God does not change his mind. He called you, and he's not changing his mind. Whom the Lord loves, he rebukes and chastens. He will correct you, but he will not change his mind. So they knew not the time of their visitation. Let's go to the next slide. So now, here he goes. Let's click, and we'll see the red path. There he goes. He goes up and into the temple riding on the donkey, and he cleanses the temple. Just a side note, this is not the temple. When Dr. McMurtry was selling DVDs and books in here, this is not the temple. And what they were doing, they had unequal balances, which God hates. They were robbing people, charging as much as 10 to 1 on the exchange rate, and telling people, your lamb is not good. You have to buy a lamb from the temple. And they were stealing. But that was a temple. The temple was still standing. But where is the temple now? Can anybody tell me where the temple of God is now? Paul said, know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which you have of God, and you are not your own? God does not consider this a holy place. We have school in here. We have the book fair in here. When we had set up our book fair, this is not the holy temple. And besides, if somebody was in here running a casino or something, I'd probably throw them out if they were in here cheating you, just because they're cheating, not because this is a holy place. You don't have to, like we used to rent at a place and nobody was allowed up on the top, and to come into the sanctuary you had to take your shoes off and all that. And I thought, no, this is just a building. You could use this as a barn. It wouldn't offend God if I brought the donkey in here. In fact, I thought about doing it today, but I was afraid he might have an accident in here. I was going to like maybe put a little kid on him and lead him up, but I said, this carpet will probably really suffer. So I said, no way. But this is not the temple. This is not the house of God. Whose house are we? Peter said, you are all living stones which form the habitation of the Holy Spirit. As we join together as a body, we form the habitation of the Holy Spirit. Now, let's move on. So he cleansed the temple, and that really ticked off the leaders. So on his way back to Jerusalem, he goes back out again overnight. I didn't do every map because it would take too long. He's coming back to Jerusalem in the morning, and he's hungry. Now, Jesus is the creator God. You think he doesn't know that it's not time for figs? He goes to the fig tree, and there's no figs on it. And so he curses the fig tree, and he says, no figs are on you from henceforth even forever. What's that all about? What did we talk about last week with the olive tree and the fig tree? The olive branch and the fig tree. What is the olive branch? Israel. What is the fig tree? Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the fig tree. What he's saying is, there's no fruit in Jerusalem. They've rejected me. I'm the Messiah, and the fig tree has no fruit. So I'm cursing it. I'm going to curse the fig tree because they knew not the time of their visitation. And so now this unfruitful fig tree is going to be cursed, and it's going to go on hold. This is 69 weeks now. 483 years, it's been the 69 weeks of Daniel, and Daniel said there's a 70th week, but in the midst of the 69 weeks, the Messiah shall be cut off. He's going to be cut off. He's rejected and cut off, and Israel is going to go on hold, and God's going to turn to the Gentiles, and later, after the fullness of the Gentiles, when he takes them, he's going to deal with Israel for the 70th week, 7 years, which we call the Great Tribulation, 3.5 years of minor tribulation, and then 3.5 years of the wrath of God, the bowl judgments, and etc. So that's coming soon. That will be the 70th week of Daniel. But they're on hold. There is no fruit. Individual Jews can be saved, but God is not dealing with Israel as a nation or Jerusalem right now. That's coming. They're going to be surrounded again. It's a double fulfillment, as often with the book of Daniel and other prophecies. There was a fulfillment in 70 AD, and there will be another one when Jerusalem is surrounded, and they can only call on Jesus to save them. They won't even have an ally. As you see now, their biggest ally, the United States, is now not their ally, because now the United States is not for anything, as far as our government officials, anything that has to do with Jesus or with God the Father. I didn't say that. I did say that. I'm not ashamed of that. Okay, let's go to the next slide because it's the truth. So he curses a fig tree, and we can move on to the next one because we talked about that already. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto you. How many prophets did they kill? Constantly. You come, you tell the truth, we kill you. You come and tell me what God said, I don't like it. John the Baptist said, hey, Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother Philip's wife. Cut his head off. He didn't do it exactly, but when his adulterous wife's daughter danced and pleased him, he said, ask what you want. His mother said, get John the Baptist's head in the charger. Cut his head off and brought it. That's what telling the truth will do when people hate the truth and hate God. So thou that stonest the prophets that are sent unto you, how often would I have gathered your children together, even as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, and you would not. I tried to gather you. I tried to save you, and you refused. You would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. I was going to play a little clip from Jesus of Nazareth today. It was like 3 minutes, but the events in there are like not in order. He shows the man that was born blind at the pool of Siloam. But on there, Jesus turns to them as he tells the Pharisees and the priests and all who are there. They come to challenge him, and he said, You're whited sepulchers. How can any of you escape the damnation of hell? You're all vipers. And when he leaves, he turns around before he walks out of the temple and he says, you will not see me here again, not until you learn to cry, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. And when Jesus said that and left, he was telling them, Israel is a nation, you won't see me again until the day when you cry, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Because I came in the name of the Lord and you rejected me. Another will come in his own name, him you will receive. When the Antichrist comes, they will receive him in his own name. They wouldn't receive Jesus in the name of his Father. Okay, let's move to the next slide. So they plotted to kill Jesus. They said, kill him. If you're telling the truth, get rid of him. The chief priests, scribes, and other leaders of the people heard what Jesus did in cleansing the temple, so they tried to find a way to kill him. That night, Jesus went out of the city to the Mount of Olives. Let's move to the next slide. So he goes back to the Mount of Olives, if you click on it. All right. Let's move to the next slide now. The next morning, they're coming in, and Peter says, hey, look at the fig tree. You just cursed it yesterday. It's withered all the way from the roots now. It completely dried up overnight. And Jesus had faith in God. If you shall say to this mountain, be removed. But the fig tree withered to show that Jerusalem is done now. Jerusalem, you have withered. That fast, the curse has taken place. Jerusalem as a whole is done. Individuals will be saved, of course. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So we're going to try to get to Wednesday. But as you know, Jesus is speaking his demise. The Passover is 2 days away. So the Passover is on Thursday. The Passover lamb is offered at 3 p.m., right? That's when you kill the Passover lamb. And the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. All right, let's move on. Jesus talks about his death. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth on a cross, I'll draw everyone to myself. Jesus said that if people believe in him, they believe in the Father. He that hears my words and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is already passed from death unto life. See, we're not going to have eternal life. We've already passed into eternal life. We're just still hanging out in these bodies. But I already have eternal life. Eternal life is Jesus. You have eternal life abiding in you, and you shall never perish. The Holy Spirit is a seal on our lives until the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit is an earnest or a down payment, guaranteeing that God will, if I put a down payment, I'm finishing it. That's his guarantee. Okay? Several authorities, he says, Jesus said that if people believe on him, they believe on the Father. Yet the people doubted him and were blinded to the truth. Several authorities believed in Jesus. Who were they? Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea. But they kept it to themselves. They were afraid that if they confessed, they'd be put out of the synagogue, and they would have been. Okay, let's go to the next slide. This is still Tuesday. Jesus predicts his crucifixion. After saying all these things, Jesus told his disciples that after 2 days, the Passover was coming. He said that he would be handed over to the authorities, and they would crucify him. At this time, the chief priests and scribes were still looking for a way to kill Jesus, but they were afraid of a revolt within the crowds if they did. Jesus left Jerusalem and stayed the night at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. Now, remember, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus are in Bethany, too. And the authorities also want to kill Lazarus because people are traveling there to see him and believing in Jesus. So they said, we've got to kill him, too. So Jesus stays at Simon the leper's house, and this is what happens. Let's move on. So while he's there, you can just click that past. He goes all the way back down to Bethany. All right, click that. Here comes, this is what happens in the house. As Jesus sat at the table, a woman came and poured some very expensive ointment on his head. The disciples were upset that the woman was wasting this ointment. It could have been sold for a lot of money and given to the poor. It actually wasn't the disciples. It was Judas Iscariot because he was a thief and he was a treasurer. He got to carry the bag of money. And he thought, wow, we could have sold that for a lot and I could have pocketed it. He's stealing from the money Jesus is using for ministry. Jesus told them to leave the woman alone. He said that she was preparing his body for burial and that she would always be remembered for doing it. She was anointing him as you do a dead body with perfumes. So she took the spikenard and anointed the body of Jesus. Let's move to the next one. So here we come Wednesday. Jesus institutes the Last Supper. This is the evening of Passover. So that evening at dark, it becomes the 14th, and they're eating the Passover at dinner. So Jesus said, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is broken, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Why is Jesus saying you have to eat my body? What did you have to do with the Passover lamb? You had to kill it, use the blood for covering your sins, right? And you had to eat it in haste. You had to eat it. Jesus is the bread of life. Does anybody know where Jesus was born? Bethlehem. Bet is the second letter of the Hebrew alphabet. You have alphabet, gemet, dalet, hey, like that. So Bet is the second letter, and it means house. Bethlehem means house of bread. Jesus was born there because he is the bread of life. So he came from the house of bread, and that's why he's offering the bread. You must eat my body as the Passover lamb to have part with me, to have life. He took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament and my blood, which is shed for you. Remember, without shedding of blood, there is no remission, no forgiveness of sins. That blood is what washes away our sin. Washes it away, does not cover it. Let's go to the next slide. And so now, after, back up one. So as soon as Passover is over on the 14th, the 15th starts the Feast of Unleavened Bread for a week. This still happens. So today, the Jewish people are starting the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Today is Sunday. Their Sabbath was yesterday. But today is a Sabbath. It starts with a high day. The Feast of Unleavened Bread starts with a Sabbath, regardless of what day of the week it is. It is a Sabbath, and it ends on the seventh day with a Sabbath. So now they're having a Sabbath today and a Sabbath next Sunday. So in Jesus' day, the regular Sabbath was Saturday. But on Thursday, when Jesus died on the cross at 3 p.m., they said, we can't leave his body on the cross because tomorrow is a high day. It's not a regular Sabbath. It's a high day. It's the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The next day will be the Sabbath again, but this is a special Sabbath that comes only once a year at the beginning and end of Unleavened Bread. So people say, oh, Jesus died on Friday. He did not die on Friday. If he did, that makes the Bible a lie. Oh, we figured out you can take the evening and make it a day. Jesus said, as the Son of Man, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the earth. So they try to figure out, well, here he died Friday, and Friday night was a night, and Friday morning was a night, and Saturday night. No, it's not. The reason that it said the next day was a Sabbath, it said it's a high day, not a Sabbath. It's a high day, not a regular Shabbat. So the next day is the first day of unleavened bread, and it's a high day, a holy Sabbath. So Jesus died on Thursday, went into the grave Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, out of the grave he came. Okay? So there's no such thing as Good Friday. It's Good Thursday, really. And I see people, like you, there's lots of articles on it, and some people say, it's not a big deal. It is a big deal, because Jesus doesn't lie. He said 3 days and three nights. And the next day was a high day. So the Feast of Unleavened Bread started with a high holy Sabbath, and it will end 7 days later with a high holy Sabbath. We're going to go next week into the whole crucifixion, and we'll go into seeing our redemption. We're not just having our sins forgiven by the spilt blood. We're being bought with a price, bought by the Father with the blood of his Son. John 17, the real Lord's Prayer, Jesus will pray that we are one with him as he's one with the Father. He'll promise the Holy Spirit in John 14. And so all this is going to take place now. We're only up to Wednesday now. I wanted to go ahead and mention Thursday, but next week we'll talk about the death and the resurrection. May God help us all to see the great price that was paid for us. That's love. That's love. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we just thank and praise you for your great love wherewith you have loved us. Thank you, Jesus. I just can't imagine. This week I keep thinking what you must have been feeling, knowing what was about to happen to you, knowing the terrible rejection, the beatings, having your skin beat off you, having your organs exposed, being nailed to a cross, and that's only the human part. But bearing the weight of the sin and shame of the whole world from Adam to the last person, it's just beyond our comprehension what you suffered. And then to give up dimensions of your being. And you were willing to do it. You said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Who would want to go into that horrible suffering? But you loved us so much that you looked ahead in time, and when you were on the cross, we were on your mind. You knew us, but you loved us. So, Lord, we just thank you. Help us to live in appreciation and full surrender, to let you live your life through us, to bring glory to your name, glory to the grace, all for the praise of the glory of your grace. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Let's sing this last song. Just thank you, Jesus, for all he did. Hallelujah.
Love me and
Salvation. Amen.
I wanted to mention a couple things. Our trip is this Friday. For those of you, we have quite a group of people going to Sight and Sound to see David. So usually we would get the bus and go. I could have borrowed a bus, but people said they kind of wanted to go on their own. There are people who need rides, so if you have extra room, if we can coordinate, our brother Alex will need to get there, and I know one of the ladies who does our aftercare, she and her grandson are going. So I don't know if some of us might want to meet here. If I need to, I'll borrow at least a minibus if there's people without a ride. I want to make sure everybody has a ride and is comfortable. So if we can kind of communicate this week and get this together, it would be great. I also want to ask special prayers. At my daughter's church up in the Poconos, there's no Christian schools for about 50 miles, so God put it upon them to start a Christian school. And the devil has been trying to wreak havoc with all kinds of division and problems and attacks upon the people who are trying to start the Christian school, things being said about them, and just all kinds of. I want you to pray for Pocono Christian School, Pocono Mountain Christian School. I have it in the prayer in the bulletin as a prayer. Please pray for them, because you can see how the devil's trying to stop this. He does not want this to start, just as he fought us in so many ways. So please keep them in your prayers. I know they have on Facebook. If you want to help out and maybe donate to get started, it would be great. You know, they need a few things. But at least, like, just keep them in your prayers that God will overrule this. It's not surprising. I saw Denzel Washington speaking the other day, and he said, if the devil is not bothering you, there's probably something wrong. If he's leaving you alone, he's probably saying, I've already got you. But he said, you try to do what God asked you to do and watch how the devil attacks you, because it's the truth. If you're going in the right direction, he is really going to try to put up a barricade, especially for a Christian school to start and people to be rescued from a lot of the agendas that are being taught. And you know what they are. I'm not even going into detail. So please keep that in prayer. So let's communicate about getting rides for people if we could. All right. Thank you. God bless you.